We go to the next speaker, Anton Culaga from the Institute of Biochemistry of the Romanian Academy of Sciences, who will talk about federated learning on human data for biological age prediction. Please, Anton.
Okay, so do you see my slides? Okay, so thank you very much for the introduction. So today I will be talking on a simulation study that we are doing on applying federated learning technology on human data for age prediction. So the study is motivated actually by one simple question. Why we see so many magnificent results of applying machine learning models to general problems, like differentiating cats from dogs better than humans can do, while in the same time we see that in domains that matter, like biomedical domain, the results are extremely modest. And on the right picture, you can actually see an example of such type of mistakes. So if we look into the common workflow that is used when you work on machine learning problem, you can see that if you're working on a popular general problem, usually what you do, you download the data set, you train a model, you tune a model, and another CATS classifier is ready. While when you are working with some sensitive data, like biomedical problem data, before you can even download a data set, you actually have to acquire it. It means that you have to somehow purchase the data set from the hospital. And for this, you probably need money. You have to get investors, make business plan, make business, spam everybody. Or if you are an academic group, you have to make a consortium and win a grant. That is also quite hard. So the main problem is getting access is hard. And for this reason, most of us focus on solving tasks that are accessible and getting quite good results. But what about actually focusing on tasks that matter, like solving different diseases and addressing the main disease, aging? And in aging, what is special about is, as it affects all of us, it has one especially important particular property, is that you can take a clinical study on pretty much any disease, and you can take out all the healthy control from them. And you can use this data to train an aging classifier because you can know the age of these people. That means that in theory, we can use pretty much any clinical data set to train an aging predictor. And so many, many thousands data sets can potentially be available for us. But the problem is that it's too many data sets, and we have a lot of regulations like GDPR, like HIPAA. And the trend is that regulations are getting tougher and tougher. And you can easily feel it by enormous amount of cookies that you have to accept when you surf web. And many people use technology like cookies blockers or acceptors in order to make web surfing great again. And for sensitive data, things are even harder and become even tougher. So we also need technologies to make data science and machine learning great again for biomedical data. And there are five core privacy preserving AI technologies. So by privacy preserving, I mean that you can train a machine learning model on the data that you cannot actually see, where you cannot see individual patients. So two last of them actually require quite some hardware and are pretty slow. So we looked into first three of them, and for synthetic data and federated learning, we trained some models in order to do comparisons. So few words that, as a disclaimer, it's intermediate results. So we trained the simple models to see what are the trade-offs, how much accuracy you lose if you try to protect your patient inputs in order to not to know it. As a dataset, we took GTX dataset that is public, quite popular dataset with 53 tissues and more than 800 people. As you can see on this violin plots, it's quite imbalanced. And it also has one problem that they rounded ages to make it anonymized. For these reasons, the predictions with this dataset is not as good as if you would have proper aging values. So we trained the following models. So in the middle, you can see classical centralized models when you have access to all the data and you train either neural network or you train decision tree gradient boosting model. And we also, on the bottom, we also tried to simulate four private kind of hospitals that have this data, and you train on it and get some results with federated learning. And on the top, you can see that we also tried to make some generative models kind of generation and teach some classifiers on not private data, but generated data. So a few words about centralized results. So on the left, you can see the genes that were selected with Shapley additive explanations. There we applied two models and surprisingly, LightGBM gradient boosting decision tree model performed better than neural network. And it was somewhat more robust. So we used it as a standard of the art and we compared it with first synthetic data that is generated with variational autoencoders. So in this like theoretical explanation, you can see that you have some parameters. Here it's just some facial features, but in our case it was age. So you can generate a gene expression for particular tissue, for particular age. And the idea is that you train a generative model on private data to which you have access, and then you make public synthetic data and whole world can train on synthetic data. So here is a quite simple architecture of our variational autoencoder. Here is reconstruction loss. And the second technology that we compared with centralized was federated learning. For this, we use famous PyGrid library. So federated learning is what you all experience when you work with your mobile devices, because type suggestions and other services are actually machine learning models trained in a federated manner when they don't send all the data all the time to central server, but they try to train it on device and send model updates. In biomedical setting, you can actually see that it can be quite painful in terms of paperwork and privacy regulation to just give data from a hospital to a third party. And if the data cannot go, like in the picture in the center, to the model, to some centralized location, the model can go to the data. So we have some centralized model. We send it to all the hospitals. Inside the hospitals, they train on their own machines without giving away any data, those models. And then they return back not the data, the data stays in place, but updates of the global model that are merged, and you have model 2.0, you again send it to all hospitals and you have a second, third and more federated rounds. We had the Google Summer of Code project to actually research it a little bit. And we played with Pi network that is like a way how you can dynamically make connections between data scientists slash model owners with data owners who can be hospitals or companies, and how you can dynamically organize federated learning. So our experience, unfortunately, was mostly about dealing with extremely popular, but quite immature libraries. And we spent most of time of it instead of tuning the models. And as I mentioned, here is actually comparisons of all the models. So as expected, centralized models, they perform the best with R-square about 0.6. If it would be not rounded data, it would be better, or if we would spend more time on tuning. For light GBM, we could even decrease number of features. For synthetic models, we actually didn't manage to train an external model only based on synthetic data. The results were quite poor, but we figured out that you can at least substitute half of the data. Maybe half of the data is private and half of the data is public. So you substitute half of the data with synthetic data and you get pretty decent results. For federated learning, actually, hyperparameter optimization and is quite complex because you can have different ways how the data can be imbalanced and distributed. So overall, you often get two times poorer results, unfortunately, but we are still tuning it. And there are sometimes problems with convergence. So after like doing these comparisons, we came to some conclusions. So we see that there is still a huge potential to use a lot of data from other diseases and have distributed a network of models and data sets. Unfortunately, accuracy is a price to fit with the regulation and to do everything private. And we probably need to wait 1-2 years when we can train staff with real patients in a totally secure way and with proper accuracy. And also, we cannot just use generative model everywhere yet. And our next steps actually will be testing two other privacy-preserving technologies like homomorphic encryption and secure multi-party computation. And we have to put a lot of time actually on improving the models and seeing how we can train better. With this, I want to thank you for your attention and ready to answer your questions.
Thank you very much, Anton. David asked, Anton, can you read for yourself or you want me to?
Okay, let me just check. Maybe you can read because I'm...
Okay, and in all the talk yesterday on Godfellow, the originator of the AI concept of GANs, the generative adversarial networks, talked about using GAN for differentially private data generation. This matches column one of your comparison. What problems do you see with it? It was also stated that in that webinar that knowledge about GANs has...
So I kind of thinking about taking this Coursera specialization. So there is a specialization on GANs by Andrew Ng. So the thing is that we haven't tested the GAN here yet, but we plan to. So GANs, they from one side there are a bit, you can get a bit better results than with variational autoencoders. From another side, as you have like a sword and shield fight, it's harder to train them. So it's can be hard to actually get results that are very, very close to real data. And from what we see now, probably until there will be some breakthroughs, we would think that they would be used like data augmentations, like you can say train some GANs on private data and you mix it with public data and you get better or comparable results. I think that's probably the use case for the next 1 or 2 days, but of course things can get better. Any other questions?
I think that's it. Thank you very much, Anton. Exactly on time.